Let me pray for the message, if I can. Lord God, we thank you for your word. Lord, may your word speak volumes to our hearts today. Lord, we're open to hear you speak in such a way that it'll be practical, spiritual, and applicable to our lives right where we are. So bless this message, Lord. Use it for your purpose. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Well, we've been talking about the topic, what does NLC look like? And we've had several passages of Scripture we were looking at. On January the 1st, we started this series of messages. That message was entitled, What Does a New Testament Church Look Like? And if you remember, we looked at Acts 11, 19 to 30, Acts 13, 1, 2, 3, and Acts 14, I think 26 to 28. And so then the following 2 weeks after that first message, we broke it down into messages entitled, What Does NLC Look Like? And there's 12 characteristics that we've been looking at, and we got through five of them already. So today we'll continue with one more of those characteristics. But before we get into that, I wanted to emphasize this point, that these characteristics of the church, and they're very important characteristics, and they're important for New Life Christian Assembly of God, but they're also important for each and every person that attends here as well. And this makes sense to me in my heart, in my mind, because we make up this fellowship. So when we say, what does NLC look like, we're saying, what do we look like? But even in a bigger picture than that, if this is not your church or your place where you fellowship, these characteristics are important for each of us as a Christian person. These are things in the Word of God that we should really incorporate in our lives and take with us wherever we are and wherever we fellowship. So the first thing I want to share is that, in case you didn't know, which I'm sure that you do know, but the church is people. And the characteristics of the people make up that fellowship or that church. So when we say this is how we look, this is really how the church looks, because we are the church. But the local church also has a very unique identity. Based on the scripture from Acts chapter 2, verse 42, that after 3,000 souls got saved that day, on the day of Pentecost, they were baptized in water. It says that they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine, in fellowship, in breaking of bread, in prayers. And from this, we have a model or a concept of what the church really looks like. Now, how they got 3,000 people together to continue in the apostles' doctrine, etc., they didn't have a big building like some of our churches today. They probably met in small groups in homes down by the riverbank in some park somewhere in the marketplace, and certainly they met in the synagogues. But they met consistently, steadfastly, purposefully, without wavering. It became a way of life. So wherever they were the church. And wherever they were, they incorporated the doctrine, the fellowship, the communion time, and the prayer time into what they were doing as a body of believers. This reminds me of a very important scripture, 1 Corinthians 12:12, reading from the Message translation. It says, you can easily see how this kind of thing works. In other words, how the church works. We can see very easily how this thing works by looking no further than our own body. Your body has many parts, limbs, organs, cells, but no matter how many parts you can name, you're still one body. It's exactly the same with Christ. So we, being many different pieces, different parts, make up the body of Christ. Locally, we make up New Life Christian Assembly of God. Galatians 3 and Colossians 3 tell us things like whether we're Jew or Greek or slave or free or male or female or barbarian or Scythian, we are all one in Christ Jesus. That word Scythian, I remember speaking on that a few weeks ago. And upon further study, I didn't know what the, does anyone know what the word means? Maybe some of you Bible students, Bible college. A Scythian, it's an area. Scythia is an area in present-day Middle East. And those people were advanced in many ways. But upon further investigation, they were more corrupt than the barbarians were. They were just advanced culturally, but they were very immoral, ungodly people. So whether you're a regular barbarian or someone really worse than a barbarian, if you get saved, if you come to Christ and you're in Christ, we are all together as one family, working together for a greater good. So in our case, no matter where we come from, physically, emotionally, spiritually, if we are in Christ, guess what? We are family, and we are working together for a greater good. There's definitely a place within the body of Christ for diversity. We'll see that as one of the characteristics probably next week or the week after. Psalm 133 makes it clear, oh, how good and pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. No matter where we come from or who we are, but when we're in Christ and we dwell together in unity, it's like oil dripping on the beard of Aaron. It's like the dew on the mountain surrounding Jerusalem, where the Lord declares life forevermore. So there's a place for all that. We'll get to that in a couple of weeks. So let's look at the characteristics so far, in case you missed it or in case you need a refresher. We're in Acts chapter 11, so you could turn in your Bible if you would. And starting at verse, I'm just going to go quickly to highlight these things. Verse 19, we see that the church in Antioch, now we're using the Antioch church as our model. So in verse 19, when the disciples came to Antioch, they began to preach to the Jews only. So we thought, okay, they're traditional. They're doing what the believers at that time did traditionally. They didn't branch out too far. They brought the message to the Jews first. And so that's what they did. And we figured from that, okay, we need to do some traditional things, like meet on the first day of the week, like have communion, like baptize people in water, like have weddings and funerals and baby dedications and Bible studies and preaching the word and going out to evangelize, all traditional things of the church. But in verse 20, we read that some brothers came from different places and they met the Hellenist Jewish people that didn't speak the language. They spoke Greek. So they were unreached. So we said, okay, the people there became creative. They figured out a way to reach that people group. And they preached to them. And from that, we figured, okay, we've got to learn to speak the language of other people in our community. The language of, say, the nursing home. The language of the prisons. The language of the streets, perhaps. And so we try our best to be creative to present this gospel to everybody, every people group. Then verse 21, it says that the hand of the Lord was with them. A great number believed and turned to the Lord. And we thought, okay, whatever they did, they were evangelical. They had a purpose in what they were doing. They were trying to win souls to the kingdom of God. Then verse 22, we see that they were accountable. Because when the church in Jerusalem heard about what was going on in Antioch, they sent down Barnabas to kind of check out the situation and oversee what was going on. So we talked about being accountable, churches being accountable, pastors and leaders being accountable, and every church member being accountable. And then we talked about last week, verses 23 and 24, that when Barnabas came, he was so encouraging to the church. And the church was an encouraging church. I love the phrase, when Barnabas came, he saw the grace of God at work. He saw God moving amongst the people there. So they were an encouraging group. And today we're going to look at one more piece of the puzzle, one more characteristic. And it's found in verses 25 and 26, where it says that Barnabas departed for Tarsus to look for Saul. And when he found Saul, he brought him back to Antioch, and Paul stayed there for 1 year teaching the people there. And it says that the disciples were first called Christians in Antioch. So we're calling this one identity. Every church must have an identity. So if we're a Christian church, and we are a Christian church, but any Christian church has an identity of being Christian, right? I mean, that's what we are. We're Christians. But I think that every local church has another identity attached to them. I could name some churches in town that have a certain identity. One church that I know, they are identified by being a real missions-minded church. They have established churches and preaching points in other countries. And they take great measures to make sure that they send money. They go down there for mission trips consistently. And that's what basically what they're all about. They're a missions-minded church. Another church I know in town is really into discipleship. They teach. They're systematic. They don't do much outreach, but they're very strong in discipling the believer. And so it goes. There's different churches with different personalities or different styles of ministry. But what makes our fellowship distinct? What gives our group an identity? Well, if I talk to people, if I talk to you or people that have been here before, most people would say, we love to worship. We love to be evangelical. We're engaged in the community. We're a multicultural. We're culturally diverse. That's an identity. But how do we summarize our identity? And this is what I want to speak about today. So when thinking about that, I decided it was time to preach this message to highlight our mission statement. And our mission statement is found over there, in the back up there, and when you walk in the door over there, the word grow. And so I want to talk about the word grow today. And I think probably half of the church is familiar with it. The other half has maybe heard it, but doesn't really grasp the whole meaning of it. So today is your day to get the whole ball of wax. So we'll be looking at one characteristic, and that is the characteristic of our identity. But the real mission statement begins like this: people grow at NLC. So the first thing that identifies NLC is that we're about people. The first thing that we're about is people. Who doesn't like people? Don't raise your hand. But people are the most complex, entertaining, interesting, mysterious creations that exist on the earth. Can I get an amen? People are definitely interesting. Look around. How many love to go to a mall and just forget about the stuff you want to buy? Just look at people. Go to a sporting event, you know, go to a concert, go to a busy airport and just check out people. People are fascinating when you really think about it. Go to a church, see how people respond to the presence of God, to the Holy Spirit. So in thinking of our identity, we have to grasp this. People are God's best creation, and people are fascinating. Now, with that comes all sorts of issues. Now, you know, no one's going to candy coat this. With all our fascination of being a person comes a whole lifetime of, some of us have suitcases of baggage. Some have little envelopes of baggage, but we all have something we bring to the table, and people are complicated. But our identity is with people. We love people. We accept people. We appreciate people. What that means is we accept people, love people, appreciate people that don't necessarily look like me or you. Come on. People are people. We don't necessarily love and accept and so forth people that are from the same place, the same city, the same state, or the same country even. We love people that may speak a different language or an additional language than what we speak. We embrace people that are of different ages, different cultures and races, different backgrounds, different education levels, different social status. But when we think about our identity, we're a church that embraces people. I want to really stress this to everyone. I mean, we're about God. I mean, we could get real spiritual and say, well, we're all about God. Yeah, but how does that manifest itself? God loves people. God so loved the world that he gave, right? So let's just get beyond that. We're spiritual people. We love God. We're all about God. However, God called us to be a witness to people because he loves people. I would say probably everyone in this room, that when you accepted Christ, it was because someone, a person, shared faith with you, shared the word with you. And it was a one-on-one situation, or maybe a preaching situation, when a person was used to bring you into the presence of God. And so we embrace this concept that we love people. Now that means a lot, you know. That means we also will love people that are not yet saved. Can I get an amen? We may love people that have some stuff going on in their lives that isn't good or healthy even, but we're called to love people. We may love people, or we are called to love people that have a different lifestyle than we do. We're called to love people that even have a different religion than we do, you know. But we're called to love people. So that means when we're in church, let's break it down. When a person comes into the church, a family, a child, a teen, a young adult, an adult, an elderly person, a grandparent, they are automatically candidates to grow in Christ if we look at it the right way. I mean, I look at every person that comes here as an opportunity to share faith with, to encourage in their spiritual journey. So here, I want to give you the four, we're going to call them four building blocks of our mission statement, which really defines our identity. Okay, so the first building block is signified by the letter G, which stands for grounded in the Word. So if you look at it like if you could imagine in your mind a literal block, the first thing that people who come in here, and all different sorts of people, the first thing we would like them to do, we want to help them to do, is get grounded on the Word of God. Otherwise, we're a social club. We may do some good works, but if we don't get the Word of God, we're missing our point. And you know, opinions change. You ever notice how even in the medical field, you know, like you hear something for so many years, this is what you have to do for this problem, and all of a sudden someone says, no, that wasn't right. It's going to be this way now. Oh, okay. Or even like financial advice or social science information, different things. And people come here with all sorts of things in their mind. In this information age, people have a lot of information floating around their mind, a lot of social media stuff. And a lot of things change, and they alternate between what they believe. But when they come here, we need to make sure people are receiving the Word of God. You know why? The Word of God never changes. The Word of God is the only thing that will last forever. So we want to help people get grounded on the Word of God to build their life upon the solid rock of Jesus Christ. That's what we're all about. So we have some scriptures, Psalm 119, 105. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet, a light unto my path. Thy word. Your word, O God, is a lamp. It's a light. It shows me how to go, where to go, how to live. So when someone comes into this place, our mission is to help them get grounded and established in the Word of God. That means we not only do we have to preach it, we have to live it and model it for other people. 1 Peter 1:23 and 24, it says, you've been born again, not by corruptible seed, but by the incorruptible seed of the Word of God. And it says in that passage, the grass withers and the flowers fade, but what? The Word of God endures forever. So we're all about God's Word, getting people into the Word of God. Hebrews 4:12 says, the Word of God is living and active and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of soul and spirit, joints and marrow, is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. The Word of God is the only thing that will penetrate someone's soul, someone's spirit. Do you remember the first time you heard the Word of God being proclaimed over you? I do. Man, it was like a sword going into me. Like, whoa, I never heard that. I never felt that before. So we're all about getting the Word of God out there and having people's lives grounded in the Word of God. So everything that we do, every service we have, every ministry we have, has an element, has a piece of the Word of God. It's our first building block. So whether it's Sunday mornings, Sunday nights, adult Sunday school, our youth group, our kids ministries, our young adults Nexus group, whatever we do, we get grounded in the Word of God. And just to highlight one thing that happened on our Wednesday nights, over the 3 years, you may have heard this, it took 3 years of Wednesday nights to go through the book of Ephesians. 3 years of Wednesday nights to go through the book of Ephesians. Now we started 1 Timothy, which succeeds that, and we started in November, and last Wednesday we just finished chapter 1. So if you want to get grounded in the Word of God, you can. No one will twist your arm to do so, but you can get grounded in the Word. That's what we're all about. We want to get people grounded in the Word of God. Okay, the second block is signified by the letter R, which stands for relationships and caring about people. So we have the first building block, grounded in the Word. Once that's, you know, pretty much going on, we try to help people get, you know, build good relationships with other people. We look at it like this. We've been reconciled to God. We're growing in our faith in the Word. And now it's time to begin to be reconciled with humanity. And many people will say, now that's the hard part. And sometimes it is the hard part. But the Great Commission says to go into all the world and preach, etc. It's hard to do that if we have angst against people. It's hard to preach love and not live love. And we've got to figure out a way to be at peace with one another. So it starts here in the household of faith. It starts here in the church. Jesus said in John 15, this is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. So let's put diversity aside. That's not even the main issue. The issue is whoever is in Christ, we are called to love them and to embrace them and to work with them. John 13:35 says, by this all will know that you're my disciples if you have love for one another. So we're called to love each other. And we kind of broke this down into different levels. It begins in the church. We have a great opportunity here. I'm really happy about this. We have a unique privilege and opportunity to relate to people from different countries, different cultures, different nationalities, different life experiences. We have people here working on their PhD, and some are working on their GED, fellowshipping together. We have people that come from uptown, people that come from downtown, if you know what I mean. People that are married, divorced, widowed, single, just trying to get along and trying to serve the Lord. We have young people, old people. We have new Christians and older Christians. And we have all sorts of people within the body of Christ. And whenever there's an issue, whenever people get together, often sometimes someone will rub someone the wrong way and there could be a potential problem. But we're all about trying to work out those problems, like Philippians 4:3. Help these women get along. Help these women that are of value to me. Help them to get along. And so we're about trying to mend relationships and help relationships in the church. But it also goes beyond the church. I would say it includes families. I've been in the ministry now for a long time, since the late 80s, actually. And if there's one issue that keeps coming up over and over with people of faith, it's issues regarding their families. But did you ever notice in the Word, there are many families mentioned in the Word of God? Listen to this. Moses had a brother and a sister. They were all together working for the kingdom of God. Joseph had his 11 brothers. David had brothers. Jesus even had brothers and sisters. There was James and John, the two brothers. There was Peter and Andrew. There was Lydia and her household, Cornelius and his household, the Philippian jailer, his household. And so you get the idea that, okay, when someone gets saved in a family, when no one else is saved, the question is, how does God want to use me within my family setting? And sometimes it gets a little sticky, gets a little difficult. But I would say this, maybe the Lord has saved you or me first in the family to be a witness for everybody else. I always say this, like I told you this before, whenever I'm in that situation and I feel the Holy Spirit nudging me to say something or do something within my personal family back home, I always say, Lord, why do I have to do this? And the Lord always says, because you're the Christian. And I say, oh yeah, I forgot, you know. So why do we have to do that? We're the Christian. So we're the ones that need to bring some type of salt or light into the family situation. So, and then it goes deeper beyond family. It could be friends. It could be co-workers, classmates, or whatever. So all these different areas of relationships, we're about trying to be a good witness for people. I never want to be a stumbling block for someone coming to know Christ. I'd rather be part of the solution than part of the problem. So we're about building relationships, trying to mend and heal relationships. Romans 12, 18, Paul writes, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everybody. Wow. That means I've got to do all that I can do to live at peace with people. That's a lot. That's a lot of responsibility. Hebrews 12, 14 says, pursue peace with all people. Okay. Well, Lord, I don't want to be at peace with them. I don't like them. No. You're called to be at peace with all people. As far as it depends on you, figure something out to be at peace with them. If they want to be obnoxious, that's their problem. You as a child of God, you work it out. John 14, 27 says this, my peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you, not as the world gives, do I give it to you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. We have God's peace. Let us live in peace. And I'll tell you what, it'll stretch you. It'll mature you. It'll kill you in a sense, and that's the objective, for our flesh to die. So we're about relationships and caring about people. Okay, the next building block is characterized by the letter O. So we have grounded in the Word and building relationships. And note, I wouldn't try to build relationships before we get grounded in the Word. And I wouldn't try to do the letter O until we got the other two pretty much under control. But that is to be outreach-oriented, outreach and sharing. John 4:35 says, look at the fields. They are ripe for harvest. Sooner or later, in our Christian experience, we have to start looking beyond ourselves to look at the fields that are ripe for harvest. And I would say also that we don't leave the G, we don't leave the R, we continue working on those while we're doing the others. So we remain grounded in the Word. We remain aware of building relationships, and now we're beginning to think, okay, how can I look outside the box and see the bigger picture? This concept is really a biblical concept. We see it in the Old Testament as well as the New. You know, Israel was called to be a witness for God. You know, a lot of people don't realize that. Israel was called to be a witness to all the nations that God is God. 1 Chronicles 16, 24, it says, declare his glory among the nations and declare his wonders among all people. Psalm 18, 49 says, I will give thanks to you among the Gentiles. Isaiah 43, 10 says, you are my witnesses, says the Lord. In Matthew 28, Mark 16, go into all the world and preach. So we are called to be light, to give hope, to share what we know about God to all the world around us. So we are a missions-minded church. I call this the Acts 1:8 principle. When the Holy Ghost comes upon you, you shall be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, to the outermost parts of the world. Well, we have the Holy Ghost. The Holy Spirit is upon us. And we're commissioned by God to go out and be a witness for him all over the world. So we have pledged for this year $30,000 for missionaries. That's really good. I'm trusting God that it all comes in. We support about 30 missionaries right now. And they're involved with a variety of different things, preaching, teaching, literally building churches, having kids ministries. One missionary we support in Namibia has an outrageous children's ministry. It's all about kids. Others have adults. Others deal with drug addicts or human trafficking or women in crisis. You know, we support missionaries that are involved in many different aspects of Christian service. Locally, we're involved with Somebody Cares New England and Common Ground Ministries, New Brothers Fellowship, Pregnancy Care Center. Every Sunday morning, we have Pastor Wayne Zanke preaching down at the Cafe Ministry on Winter Street. So we're involved in this concept of proclaiming and being outreach-oriented. We have Hillstock coming up the last week of June. We have Serving Haverhill coming up, United Night of Worship. All these different things are coming up on the calendar because we are an outreach-driven church. It's not all about here. I mean, it's about here, but it's about beyond here as well. So when people come in here, We want to make sure that they get the message that, okay, we get grounded in the word. We build relationships. And now we begin to look at the fields that are ripe for harvest. And this is our identity. This is who we are. So remember, this is all about a characteristic of the church. We have an identity. This is who we are. We're all about people. We're all about getting grounded in the word, building relationships, and being outreach-oriented. And the last characteristic is signified by the letter W, is that we worship God with passion. We worship the Lord. Everything that we do is a worship to God. Some people might say, oh, you're the Pentecostal church. You're the guys that are really, your identity is that you're loud. Or that you worship long. Well, that might be part of our identity. You know, might be. But even beyond that, see, we do that for different reasons, but that's a result of our lives being a sacrifice to God. So we worship God not only with our songs, we do with our songs, but we worship the Lord with our lives. 1 Chronicles 16:29 says, give to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering. Come before him. Oh, worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. So give to the Lord glory. We give God honor and respect. We give him recognition. This is how we worship the Lord with passion. And not only on Sunday morning. We bring an offering. Well, we might bring our finances, but I look at it, our offering is our lives. You ever hear the story about the little girl that wanted to give an offering one day? And they had the basket down on the floor. And someone put the basket on the floor. She put herself in the basket. She said, I don't have any money, but I'm going to give myself as an offering. What a great analogy. So as we say, we bring an offering, we bring our lives to the Lord. And it says to worship the Lord, worship him with our song, with our giving, with our finances, with our good deeds, and come before him in the beauty of holiness, a pure life, a holy life. So we may sing, we may shout, we may kneel, we may raise hands, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But ultimately, it's our lives that are a worship to the Lord. This is our identity. If we're just identified by being loud and long, that's not going to go very far. But if we could be identified as a people that really love God and worship God with our life and our lifestyle, that will make an impact on people. Ephesians 2:10, one of my favorite scriptures. It says, we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. The word workmanship, we studied that in our study of Ephesians, comes from the word where we get our word for poetry. So we are God's creative masterpiece, his workmanship that he's writing, created for God for good works. And that must include our worship of God. Along those lines, I had said last Sunday at the second service, you all missed it, that one of the things we're trying to do at our second service is to get from worship into preaching a little bit quicker than we have been. So we thought we would kind of cut down our time of worship. Funny antidote. So Stacy leads worship at the second service. We normally sing 4 songs, and it normally takes 45 minutes or more. So last week she said, I'm going to choose 3 songs. And the 3 songs took 45 minutes anyway. But with that thought in mind, we're going to designate the first Sunday night of every month, the first Sunday night of every month as a worship night. So starting in February, I don't know what the date is, maybe the 2nd or whatever it is, that Sunday night will be a worship night. We're going to have any of the worship team that could come, we're just going to pick some songs, and we're going to worship for an hour and a half and see what God does. That's what we're going to do. So we want to give everyone an opportunity to worship God in that setting. The second Sunday night is a prayer night, by the way, just so you know, every second Sunday night. So what does NLC look like? Hopefully, we're a little traditional in some ways. We're creative in other ways. We're evangelical in all things. We're accountable. We're encouraging. And we have an identity. We have a mission statement. So when you get the idea that people grow at NLC, hopefully, if someone you work with or someone in your family asked you, what is your church all about? You can say, well, our church is all about people that grow, people grow. And they'll say, what do you mean? And then you could tell them exactly what we mean by that, by going through it step by step. You can have the long version or the short version, depending on the situation. But so this will be continued. Next week we'll go into probably two more characteristics. And when we're done, we'll have 12 altogether. If you need to review this sermon or see the notes, you can go online on our website, newlifechristianag.com. Go under media, and you'll find the sermon, and you'll find the sermon notes that you just saw on the screen as well. Why don't we stand together?